Will you join me in our call to worship? Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is alive.
We are not alone.
Like Jesus, we live.
Like Christ, we rise.
Christ the Lord is risen today.
Hallelujah.
Grace and peace to you. Thank you for being here. I'm glad to see you all. Happy Easter. For those of you I have not met, my name is Andy Naj Benson. As a pastor of this congregation, it is a great pleasure to welcome you and a great joy to say on this church's behalf that no matter who you are, or where you are on this journey, you are welcome here. You are always welcome here. As our worship service opens, I want to thank Mona Rogers and her team for putting together this spring garden. I would like to thank our musicians and our deacons, I would like to thank Asher and James and Jennifer and Katie for helping to lead this service. I would also like to invite you all to gather downstairs in Fellowship Hall after the service for a time of fellowship and refreshment. As we take a moment to fully arrive, I invite you to remember with me the gospel story in which the risen Lord greets his disciples with peace. His first word to them is peace. Peace be with you. Let's increase that spirit in this place, in this moment. For some, that may mean an outstretched hand. For others, a simple posture of prayer. In both, let there be blessings given and received. Would you please rise as you are able and welcome one another with a sign of Christ's peace.
God of love and peace, we enter this house of prayer with joy and wonder and hope. Be with us, O God, in our Easter joy, in trumpet and song, in friend and flower, in that wondrous word, risen. Be with us, O God, in our Easter wonder. Give our hearts the wisdom to receive that which our minds cannot understand. Be with us, O God, in our Easter hope. Tell us again how your love casts out fear and drives out hate. Tell us again how your love comes again like wheat arising green. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our crucified and risen and living Lord. Amen.
Thank you. reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 65. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy, and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food, shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Here ends the reading.
A reading from the book of the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter began to speak to the crowd. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Herein ends the reading.
Thank you.
The Easter story, according to the Gospel of Luke. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you, while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. This is the word of the Lord. Would you please pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Six words. An Easter message in six words. For a mother or father whose child is wiggling out of the pew or rolling around on the floor, a six-word Easter sermon might be considered divine intervention. For others, Easter in six words might seem a little bit light, like a sound bite from the gospel of Twitter. It might come across as overcompensation for every rambling sermon ever preached. A six-word Easter sermon might not be enough. But the thought of one was more than enough for me this past week. You see, Easter in six words was a challenge, a playful challenge, lobbed to me from an old friend. He called Monday just to talk, because old friends know that the best time to call an old friend is when an old friend thinks he doesn't have time to talk to old friends. I told him, "I'm kind of busy, man. It's Holy Week." He told me to relax. We talked a while, we laughed a lot, or at least we laughed until he asked me a question that no one should ever ask a pastor on a Monday. He said, "So what are you going to say to the church on Sunday?" I can't remember exactly what I said to him. I have a general idea. And then he said, "I've got a great idea. Preach an Easter sermon in six words." It was not a great idea. And then, you know, it wasn't a terrible idea. And then, okay, it was a pretty good idea. Easter in six words. It's a place to start. So I started. And it wasn't long before I learned that telling a story in six words is something people do. Apparently, this started years ago. An online magazine called Smith collects six-word memoirs from people who are famous and not famous at all. Now, it's not easy telling your story in six words, which is why once I started reading through these, I could hardly stop. Now, there was one from a nine-year-old girl. A nine-year-old girl, a cancer survivor. Her memoir, cursed with cancer, blessed with friends. And then there was one from the author Frank McCourt, Angela's Ashes. The miserable childhood leads to royalties. It's pretty good. One of my favorites, this one obviously from a college student, Living the Dream, Please Send Money. That's good. And there was Stephen Colbert. Stephen Colbert, whose six-word memoir reads, "Well, I thought it was funny." So you understand, newly inspired, I set out to boil the sap of all the words we use to express Easter. Here are four of my six-word Easter sermons. He is risen, go and tell. These aren't as funny. He is risen, go and tell. Nothing can separate us from God. Christ's alive. Can you believe it? Jesus is risen from the dead. I enjoyed the exercise. It was fun, and more importantly, it was clarifying. Now, clearly, a six-word sermon cannot tell the whole story, but six words are a beginning, a lead, a place to start a conversation. And you know, the Easter story, as told by Luke, is a lot like that. It's a beginning. It's a lead. It's a place to start. I mean, as a story, the Easter story, according to Luke, does not answer our questions. It does not bring closure. In fact, I think it does the opposite. It raises questions. It opens up a lot of doors thought to be permanently shut. As Luke tells it, women go to anoint the body of Jesus, which is traditional and typical. But when they get to the tomb is empty, which is not traditional or typical. And then wait, hold on, the tomb is not empty now. Now there are two messengers from God in it. That's uncommon. And then these messengers deliver a message that the women could not possibly have expected. He has been raised. That too is uncommon. So the women carry this unbelievable news back to the other disciples, who hear it and don't believe it and go back to reading the Sunday Times. Except for Peter. Peter wonders about this. I mean, what he and the others have just heard, it makes no sense. It's illogical. But what if it's true? Can it be true? Well, Peter goes to the tomb to see for himself. And he sees for himself. Mary and Joanna and the other women, they were right. Jesus is not there. So where is he? What happened? Raised? What does that mean, raised? You see, the Easter story is just the beginning. And for 2,000 years, people have said, no. Resurrection? No. That's impossible. And for 2,000 years, people like Peter and Mary Magdalene and J.S. Bach and George Herbert and Dorothy Day and Coretta Scott King and Desmond Tutu have said, yes, but he's here. He's right here. He's alive. He's with us. And how about Handel, that good Lutheran? In 1742, Handel just finishes composing the Alleluia chorus. And with tears streaming down his face, he tells the person serving him lunch, I think I did see all heaven before me, and the great God himself. And doesn't it seem fitting that the Messiah was first performed as a benefit concert? One that raised 400 pounds and freed 142 people from debtor's prison. And while we're giving out some Lutheran love, let's not forget Dietrich Bonhoeffer, courageous opponent of the Nazis. On April 8, 1945, the 39-year-old pastor was hanged in Flossenbürg just days before the Americans liberated that camp. And his last words? This is the end for me, the beginning of life. Whatever else that means, I am sure that has to do with Christ the Lord is risen today. It has to do with Jesus is risen from the dead. Which leads me to wonder, since Mary Magdalene, how many lives have been changed upon hearing those six words? How many hearts have been strangely warmed, to use a Wesleyan phrase, upon hearing those six words? And how much justice and peace and forgiveness and joy and self-giving love has been inspired by those six words? God only knows. Every year at this time of year, someone asks me whether a man named Jesus really rose from the dead 3 days after being crucified. And every year at this time of year, I say, he's here. He's right here. He's alive. He's with us. And if you really want to know, I think the more interesting Easter question is Christ alive in you? Is Christ alive in us? St. Paul, the Apostle Paul, calls the church the body of Christ. So then, is the body of Christ alive on this bright Easter morning? Is the body up for showing compassion and hospitality? Is the body up for standing in solidarity with our gay and lesbian and bisexual and transgender friends in this town and in lovely North Carolina? Is the body up for loving one another with something of Christ's heart? Is the body up for keeping extravagant welcome at the center of who we are? Is the body of Christ up for hitting the low notes of humble service? Now, when our answers to these questions make life more beautiful for us and for others, then the sweetness of Easter is as near as taste on the tongue, as a song in the air, as a six-word message delivered from my heart to yours. He is risen, go and tell. He is risen, go and tell. He is risen, go and tell. Alleluia. Amen. You made it. Thank you.
we open our hearts and we open our hands in the service of other people, we do so with confidence that as much as we give, there will be more to give tomorrow. That's a leap that we make together, and together we are stronger for it. We as a church can do so much more than any one of us could possibly do. And yet every Sunday we gather, we share as we are able to share, to strengthen our ministry in this community and well beyond it. So in the spirit of gratitude, deep gratitude, let us share as we are able, to the glory of God. Our deacons will now receive the offering.
Thank you.
Gracious God, we offer these gifts with joy, with Easter joy. Christ is alive within us and between us. And God, we share what we are able to share for your glory and for our neighbor's good. So bless this offering and multiply it many times until more people in more places can say, He's alive. He is with us. Amen.
Our morning prayer today is by one of the great American preachers and public ambassadors for Christianity of the 20th century, Harry Emerson Fosdick. Will you pray with me? Eternal God, before whom the morning stars first sang together, and who holds in your hands the destiny of every living thing, we worship you. Thanks be to you for the note of victory that fills our souls today. Thanks to you for our living Lord, over whom death had no dominion. For the rich heritage of faith, that life is ever Lord of death, and that love can never lose its own. We thank you. Strengthen our believing, confirm our confidence in you, and in life eternal. We thank you for all things excellent and beautiful that make faith in immortality more sure, for our friends who have loved us, our homes that have nourished us, for the heights and depths of the human spirit full of promise and prophecy, for all victories of right over wrong, and above all for Christ, who has brought life and immortality to light, we thank you. Join to our company today those whom we have loved and who live with you in the house not made with hands. Gather us into the fellowship of the church, past, present, and future, as we sing praise to you. We pray for those souls to whom the note of victory sounds distant and unreal. You see them, known to you, though perhaps not to us, spirits frustrated by circumstance, overwhelmed by temptation, facing grief too heavy for their unaided strength. O God, who can make the barren place rejoice and the desert to blossom like the rose, redeem stricken souls from defeat to victory. Replenish with new hope all who are discouraged about the world, who find faith in the ultimate victory of righteousness difficult. So often might triumphs over right, and the good is undone by evil, that like our master on his cross, we cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? O God, to whom 1,000 years are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night, speak to us and refresh our souls with a new hope. Lift our vision above the immediate. Illumine for us that eternal purpose which you did purpose in Christ. Say to us this Easter day that no Calvary can finally defeat you. We lay before you our concern for your church, for the great tradition of its strong and saving faith. Thanks be to you. Draw its members together into increasing unity. Grant that in these days of danger and opportunity, the gospel of deathless hope, of unconquerable faith, of invincible courage may inspire your people. Send us out from this high hour of worship to be fearless and faithful citizens of your kingdom. And to that end, may the living Christ be not only in our creed, but in our experience. Let not Easter Day represent to us only an historic victory. May it mean a present triumph in our souls, the living Christ, our inspiration and our strength, so that we live, and yet not we, but Christ lives in us, the hope of glory. In that sustaining faith, may we too, like our Master, overcome the world. We pray in the name of Christ, who calls us to embrace this gospel of life abundant, who gathers us in this community of friendship and justice that is your church, and who teaches us to pray always for the emergence of your reign in our world, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
To that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. The grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now, and remain with you always. Amen.